إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى ومن يعص الله ورسوله فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والفجر وليال عشر وقال تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Respected brothers, every so often when the spiritual heart of a believer is dead, it is void of the goodness of Iman and Islam, it lacks the love for Allah and His Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it lacks a spiritual focus and a vision of the Akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only through His infinite mercy and grace, He affords the Ummah certain dates and occasions throughout the year in order for us to one again revive the light of Iman and Islam in our hearts and our lives. This is perhaps one of the wisdom that explains why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give the Ummah Ramadan for the whole year. Because perhaps that for man is a bit too much and far-fetched. He doesn't have that level of Iman which the angels possess, where they are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 24/7. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His infinite mercy and grace, He selected certain days and nights and dates throughout the whole year, wherein if a believer was to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understand the importance of such occasion, then this individual will once again be guided on the sirata mustaqim and the right path. On a weekly basis, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted the Muslim Ummah the Friday Jumu'ah. That is the weekly revival of the spirit of Iman and Islam. Otherwise, ask yourself, where throughout the whole year are we firm on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consistently? So the weekly Friday Jumu'ah, it is the weekly opportunity for one to revive the spirit of his Iman and Islam. On a monthly basis, or once throughout the whole year, month-wise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the holy month of Ramadan to revive that spiritual dead heart with the dhikr and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Developing once again the spiritual focus and vision of the Akhirah. And then scattered throughout the whole Islamic year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the Ummah with certain days and nights and occasions wherein the sole purpose is for you and I to make ruju' and to return to our Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a total state of submission. that first 10 days and nights of the Islamic month Dhul-Hijjah is no different. Currently, dear brothers, we are in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah. Very soon, next week, Wednesday, latest Thursday, the month of Hajj, known as Dhul-Hijjah or Dhul-Hijjah, will commence. That is also occasion where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He expects the Ummah to turn to Him in His remembrance. It is such an occasion for all of us, dear brothers, to once again revive the spirit of Iman and Islam within our hearts. The heart that has died away, corrupted and corroded with the filth of the dunya and materialism. Soon after the holy month of Ramadan comes the first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again has given us the opportunity to revive our Iman and Islam, to revive our dead hearts. So to the importance of this occasion, dear brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the most glorified, the majestic, generally His sunnah is He will not take an oath by anything or anyone. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's being so great that He won't necessarily take an oath by anything or anyone. But the 10 days of Dhul-Hajj and the 10 nights of Dhul-Hajj are such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran, He takes an oath. Wal Fajr, I swear, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I swear by the Fajr time of the 10th of Dhul-Hajj, walayalin ashr, I swear by the 10 nights, the 10 nights and the 10 days of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj. According to majority of the commentaries of the Holy Quran, walayalin ashr, the 10 nights here in this surah refers to the 10 nights and days of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj. That alone, dear brothers, is enough for us to realize, without even understanding our duties during these days, without even understanding the virtues of these days, the fact that our Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sworn oath on these days and nights should make you and I aware of the importance of these days and nights. Automatically, we should be thinking, why has Allah taken oath with these first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj? There must be some importance with regards to these 10 days and nights of Dhul-Hajj. That alone for a believer should be enough to say, whatever the demands are during these 10 days, first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj, I am willing to sacrifice anything and everything in order to once again revive the spiritual heart, my spiritual heart, with the love for Allah and Rasul Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is generally a problem within the ummah. Forget about the disbelievers. I'm not talking about the non-Muslim. I'm talking about the Muslim ummah, the heart of the believers. Just go back 2 months. How was the spiritual heart pumping with the love for Allah and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during the whole month of Ramadan? That level of love, that level of spiritual focus, that level of love for Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is it still burning in our hearts and minds? That is the question we need to ask ourselves. And Allah even mentioned in the Quran, Allahu Akbar, talking about the heart being spiritually dead. أَفَمَنْ شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ فَهُوَ عَلَى نُورٍ مِّن رَبِّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you not seen that person whose heart Allah has opened for Islam, for Iman and Islam? فَهُوَ عَلَى نُورٍ مِّن رَبِّهِ. That individual whose heart Allah has opened for Iman and Islam is one that is full of nur from his creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has the nur of Allah's love, the nur of the love of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the nur of deen, the nur of Islam, the nur of Quran, the nur of the akhirah. Allah says that whoever's heart Allah has opened, his heart is full of nur. He is on the right by the sirat mustaqim. But then Allah immediately warns, فَوَيْلُ الْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. But woe and destruction be to those hearts which are hard. Woe and destruction be to the hearts of those, to those whose hearts are hard like a rock. From what? From the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, that a heart is empty of the remembrance and dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in effect, it's spiritually dead. Even though biologically and physically, it's still working. These are individuals, Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُّبِينٍ. These individuals whose heart are black. Black because it's been contaminated with the filth of the dunya, with the stains of sins and disobedience. These are people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who are in open astray and who are openly being misled. Allahu Akbar. Now the question here is, brothers, what do we mean by sharhu sadr? When Allah says here, أَفَمَنْ شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. Allah opens the heart, شَرْحُ الصَّدْرِ. What does that mean? When Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked regarding the شَرْحُ الصَّدْرِ, the opening of the heart, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, listen to this very carefully, dear brothers. He says, when the light of Iman enters the human heart, it enhances its capacity, i.e. to easily follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. It is that light of Iman. Once it penetrates the heart, it will then allow you and I to easily follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the definition of a heart which Allah has opened. Allah has expanded. And this comes through constant dhikr and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are these signs now? That's one sign, the light of Iman. How do you and I know that the light of Iman has penetrated our hearts? How do we know? Further, and this is stated in Ma'riful Quran, volume 7, page 559. I quote because sometimes this might seem quite far-fetched. But the definition of the sign of Iman being present in the heart of a believer is three signs. What are they? Number one, al-inabatu ila daril khulud. That heart is always inclined towards the eternal abode of the akhirah. Daril khulud, the eternal abode, which is the akhirah, which is Jannah, paradise. So that heart which is booming with Iman, it will always be inclined towards the eternal abode of the akhirah. His fikr and his concern in this temporary life would be, what can I think, what can I say, what can I do in order for me to be inclined towards the akhirah, in order for me to then be guaranteed a place in Jannah and paradise. Al-inabatu ila dar al-khulud. Second sign, wat-tajafi an dar al-ghurur. And that the heart is constantly declined, abstinent from the deceptive dunya. So his heart is inclined towards the akhirah all the time. At the same time, he detests the filth of this dunya. He detaches himself from the dunya. He only does whatever is required in the dunya, whatever is a necessity. Other than that, he has got no interest with the dunya at all. And the third sign, وَتَأَحْبُ لِلْمَوْتِ قَبْلَ نُزُولِ. That this heart and this individual is constantly in preparation for his death before death approaches him. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Moment for reflection, dear brothers. First and foremost, what is the state of our heart? First and foremost, what is the state of our heart? Are we amongst those people who Allah has opened up the heart? And he has put in that heart the nur of Iman and Islam? If that is the case, then you and I, we need to ask ourselves, what are the signs? From the three signs, which sign do we have in our life? Are we amongst those where our hearts are inclined towards the eternal board of the Akhirah? And at the same time, the heart detests the filth of the dunya? We're not so attached to the dunya that we forget the spiritual focus of the Akhirah? And how much preparations have we made for the inevitable death? This is the way to measure whether one has the nur and light of Iman and Islam in his heart. So once, now that we know, dear brothers, that the biggest problem facing the Ummah is that, yes, maybe the practices are there. The A'mal are there. The Salat are there. The pain of the Zakat is there. Sadaqah is there. Fasting is there. But what about the spirit, the ruh that belongs to the A'mal and the deeds? It seems like too many of us were just from the apparent, just practicing our deen. But the spirituality and the ruh, which is the main source in the A'mal, that is missing. And for that reason, sometimes when we are practicing or reading our salah, sometimes we don't feel that spirituality, we don't feel that connection. Why? Because perhaps our heart is dead. Perhaps our heart doesn't have the nur of Iman and Islam. Why? Because perhaps our hearts are not inclined towards the Akhirah. Perhaps our hearts are more inclined towards the dunya. And because of that, we've forgotten the Akhirah. Perhaps, dear brothers, we have forgotten that one day, whether we like it or not, death will overcome us. We have truly forgotten this reality of what? Of death chasing us behind and the darkness of the grave awaiting us in front. And therefore, the days of Dhul-Hajj, the first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj, is primarily for this purpose, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only does he take oath, but he expects every believing man or woman to spend these days in the dhikr and remembrance of Allah. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. A general statement and command in the Quran. O believers, remember Allah frequently. Remember Allah frequently. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَىٰ جُنُوبِهِمْ. Be amongst those intelligent individuals who remember the Lord while standing, sitting and lying down. Allahu Akbar. That individual is remembering his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in all positions. How can that individual's heart then be hard as a rock? This is the key. And this is the message and the reminder I share with the brothers here, that these days are coming, starting from Wednesday or Thursday. These are the days of Allah's remembrance. We all tend to, the West tend to celebrate Remembrance Day. Remembrance Day to commemorate what? The bravery of the soldiers who gave their lives, overlooking and turning a blind eye to all those innocent souls that lost their lives during them wars. So we all tend to remember Remembrance Day. Well, let me tell you, dear brothers, these 10 days of Dhul-Hajj are our Islamic remembrance days, where we frequently remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are such days. I quote you a few hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I conclude. Sayyidina Abu Hurairah narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what's so important about these days? He goes, no days is the worship of Allah desired more than in the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah? The first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And Allahu Akbar, an amazing thing he mentions. He goes, and this hadith is mentioned in Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. He says, the fast of these days is equal to the fast of a whole year. And the worship of these nights is equal to the worship of a Laylatul Qadr. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. In other words, what is the hadith trying to tell us? The hadith is trying to tell us that the first 10 days of Dhul-Hajj is actually a mini Ramadan. What is it? It's a mini Ramadan. Just like in Ramadan, during the day, what we were doing? We were observing the fast. And at night, we were spending in Qiyamul Layl, standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The purpose was to revive our Iman and Islam and to develop the spiritual focus of the Akhirah. The 10 days of Dhul-Hajj, according to the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is telling us what? That treat that also as a mini Ramadan. Where sooner these days start, make a point of observing the fast during the days and make a point of spending the nights in the ibadah and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the reward is there. In another hadith, it's narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fast during the first 9 days of Dhul-Hajj. And a similar hadith mentions that these are the days in which the ibadah of Allah is so beloved. So what is the instruction given by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He says, فَأَكْثِرُوا فِيهِنَّ التَّسْبِيحِ وَالتَّهْلِيلِ وَالتَّحْمِيدِ وَالتَّكْبِيرِ. These are the days where a believer should be constantly, frequently, while standing, sitting and lying, be uttering what? Be shouting and shouting out, Subhanallah, La ilaha illallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Once again reminding himself of the supreme being of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Let me just end on this note. Subhanallah. Generally we tend to translate it as glory be to Allah. Although the actual meaning is that pure is the being. Pure is the being from what? From all faults. Just recently, I attended a gathering of my honorable Sheikh, Sheikhul Hadith Mufti Inayatul Hafidahullah, from Darulum Bolton, and he mentioned this point that why he was given the dars and the lesson on the last lesson of Bukhari. Subhanallah bihamdihi, Subhanallah al-Azim. The fadila and the virtue of reciting Subhanallah bihamdihi, Subhanallah al-Azim. So he mentioned here that Allah is mentioning here Subhanallah, Tasbih and Tahmid. Why? He says that in Subhanallah, when we say that Allah is pure from all faults, how many faults are we going to count and remember? He is free from seeing, from having eyesight, from having hearing like the humans do. He is free from a place. He is free from time, etc., etc. So the Sheikh mentions Subhanallah, that when someone utters Subhanallah, that then confirm that, my Lord, you are free from all kinds of faults. Just in one term, Subhanallah. Likewise, Alhamdulillah. So again, all praise be to Allah. We tend to just utter it without realizing what does Alhamdulillah mean? Every good quality, Subhanallah, was to negate all the bad qualities and the bad defects in an individual. Tahmid, then what it confirms, all the good qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, how many qualities are we going to remember? Oh Allah, you're the most merciful, you're the most kind, you're the most affectionate, you're the sustainer. So many attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, that just by uttering Alhamdulillah, that is enough to confirm that, oh Allah, all the good quality that you possess, I declare. Allahu Akbar. And this is what these 10 days are all about, dear brother. Lots and lots of tahleel, la ilaha illallah. Reaffirm again, there is no God, there is no one, nothing worthy of worship. There is no one worthy of my life, my death, my sacrifice, other than illallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the meaning of la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Subhanallah means the same, alhamdulillah means the same. Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. You should remind yourself that, oh Allah, nothing or no one is greater than your being. Nothing or no one is greater than your being. When we have acknowledged and accepted the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now we should be in a position where we're willing to sacrifice anything and any and everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the essence of our deen. That's the essence of these 10 days of Dhul-Hajj. And when we are willing to sacrifice everything for the sake of Allah, how does that come? Then we taste the sweetness of Iman and Islam, not just in life, in this life, but in, at the time of our death, in our qabr and on the day of judgment as well. Allahu Akbar. That is the sweetness that you and I want to taste. Then whatever trials and tribulations in front of us is surplus, is nothing. Why? Because like the likes of Bilal radiallahu anhu, despite being physically tortured and persecuted, what was coming out of his mouth? Ahad, 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 ahad. One Allah, one Allah, one Allah. If anyone saw him, they'll think he's lost the plot. He's a madman. How can he, with these wounds on his body, in the burning sun of Mecca, have a rock on his chest? In that kind of situation, he still said, ahad, 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 ahad. Why? Because Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was tasting the sweetness of Iman and Islam. And that sweetness of Iman and Islam comes through the remembrance and dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the correct knowledge and understanding with regards to the 10 days of Dhul-Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all His remembrance in abundance. Ameen thumma ameen. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-azim. Wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-hakim. Astaghfirullahi li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin. Fastaghfiru min kulli dhanb. Innahu al-ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والسالكين سبيله والداعين بدعوته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وصل على المؤمن والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وبارك على محمد وأزواجه وذريته ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم عنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذك من سخطك وغضبك والنار اللهم إنا نسألك حبك وحب رسولك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقرب إلى حبك وصلى الله تعالى خير خلق محمد وعلى على آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا رب الرحيمين أقيم الصلاة ستريتني روز
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر.